Well, I'm heading now into Paris, to the Gare du Nord. It's all very different from when I first set foot in France back in the early 1960s. Then there was no Channel Tunnel, of course, and I came by ferry on a school trip to Brittany. And I must say, I fell in love with France almost immediately. But I also fell in love with the voice of a certain young singer. Tous les garçons et les filles de mon âge se promènent dans la rue de Pardieu. And I wasn't alone. Just about every teenage boy who'd heard or seen Françoise Hardy was equally smitten.
Well, it started when I was doing A-level French, and I was living in Birmingham, and the French assistant used to bring along records, and we started with Jacques Brel and Brassens and Johnny Hallyday and people like that who were, they were okay, but one day brought in a record by Françoise Hardy with a picture of her on the front, and that was it for all of us.
Mesdames, Messieurs, bienvenue à Paris. Il est 13h43, heure locale, et dans quelques instants, nous entrerons en gare de Paris-Nord.
All over the world, people must meet and part.
These days, Françoise has fans all over the World Wide Web. Before coming to Paris, I met up with a few of them.
Hello, is it Warren?
Roy in the Midlands and Warren in West Yorkshire.
I saw everybody get off the train and the platform empty, and I was just going to ring you and find out where you were.
I see you've got the Françoise t-shirt on as well.
Yeah, it's one I made myself. I used to find it useful when I went across to the record fairs at Paris, wearing this, everybody knows what you're looking for. So
Warren Gilbert is a self-confessed, painfully shy fan who runs the Françoise website. His hoard of discs and memorabilia puts my modest collection in the shade.
Yes, a lot of albums, a box of singles and EPs. I decided at one point I would try and collect a copy of every record that Françoise ever released. After one or two trips to Paris, I realised it was an impossible feat for me. There's just so many. I just hadn't realised how many there were in different countries.
Which is the most interesting of the EPs you got, would you think?
Well, this one perhaps, because it was the first one I ever bought.
Yeah.
I heard some of these songs on the radio. Yes, it'd be 1964.
It's called Françoise Hardy Sings. Yeah, Catch a Falling Star.
Mm-hmm.
In English, exclamation mark.
Catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Never let it fade away. Catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Save it for a rainy day.
1964, I would be 16. Fifth form or sixth form at school.
You were studying French at the time, were you? Yeah.
Françoise taught me all the French I know.
Across all the dormitory walls when you were a student, you would see in those days always thousands of pin-ups of this particular girl. She was a major, major icon.
The voice of the late Malcolm McLaren, best known as manager of the Sex Pistols, but also a confirmed Francophile who lived in Paris. He admired Françoise from early on, finding in her the quality seen by another fan, Cheshire-born Tony Bray.
When you compare Françoise to other female artists at the time, with the possible exception of, say, Marianne Faithfull, then you'd got people like Lulu and Cilla Black, which weren't exactly inspiring. And then along came Françoise singing fantastic songs, a beautiful, intelligent girl. I mean, she was on a completely different planet than the rest of the artists that were around at the time.
This was the girl that came to London on a wave of huge success with a song called Tous les garçons et les filles de mon âge. And this song was the first pop record out of France that made it across the whole world. And I remember reading the gossip pages of the NME, where there was Brian Jones from the Rolling Stones, Mick Jagger, John Lennon, Paul McCartney, Ray Davies, a whole host of so-called rock stars at that time, all desperately trying to sleep with Françoise Hardy, and none of them could.
What was it about Françoise that made her stand out from the so-called Yeah Yeah girls of French pop? Maybe it was her looks, the girl next door who's appealed across genders and generations. The journalist Laura Barton is a big fan. Her fixation began while she was working in a record shop in the Paris of the North, Southport.
I think it was probably an aesthetic thing originally, because I thought she looked like probably the coolest person I'd ever seen. I loved the sort of dusky sweetness of her voice. She can make things sound so magical, even though it's a very simple subject in that kind of same way as all Yeah Yeah Girl songs are kind of universal young love, that kind of thing. But she makes it sound so dreamy. I think that's the thing about her. It's the dreaminess. Her songs kind of don't live entirely in that era. You know, they still sound contemporary.
I have noticed that your hair is not dissimilar to Françoise's back in the early 60s. Is this deliberate?
Yes, it is. I've spent so many years taking pictures of Françoise to hairdressers, begging them to recreate it. I think it probably helps that my hairdresser now is a man of a certain age who actually knows who I'm talking about, so he gets it.
So let's say you're trying to achieve the Françoise look. How do you go about it? What sort of things are you trying to convey?
She actually always looked a little more as if she liked being outside compared to a lot of other, you know, 60s models to me. She looked a little bit swarthy, didn't she? So I think you should look a bit healthy, and the hair should be fringe long at the sides. I'm basically describing my haircut. She lets the femininity show through in little details. The blouse, or, you know, warm with something tougher, that kind of thing. Very, very French and elegant.
Sans joie et plein d'ennui.
I'm on the metro now, heading to the EMI offices near Montmartre, where I'm going to meet Françoise herself and conduct an interview with her. She's insisted on having an interpreter, even though it's fairly widely known that she speaks English pretty fluently. I wonder if that's to do maybe with her shyness. We'll see.
At the very moment I was born, there was an alert.
Siren, air raid.
Yes.
Yeah.
I don't know if it has maybe something to do with the fact that I'm a very anxious person. I've always been.
And were you a shy girl?
I was aware, not in a very conscious way, but I was aware that my family situation was not normal. In the first place, I thought my parents were divorced. And at that time, it was not a good thing, you know. It was a kind of shame. And in the same time, my father didn't help much financially my mother. And all the other girls, little girls, were dressed in a very different way than I was. The parents had more money than my poor mother, who was working half of the time, but who didn't have money at all. I was explaining my shyness.
But there was a time when your father came back. This is when you passed your baccalaureate, and he gave you a guitar, is that right?
My mother wanted him to do something. She asked me what I would like, and I was hesitating between a guitar and between un petit poste transistor.
A wireless radio.
Because at that time, j'avais découvert...
I had discovered
a British station, Radio Luxembourg. Radio Luxembourg, your station of the stars. At that time, you could hear Elvis Presley, Cliff Richard, Connie Francis, Brenda Lee, people like Marty Wilde.
These were your early influences then, really?
Yes, the Everly Brothers. They probably were my main influence, especially one of them, which is called, and which I still listen to, So Sad.
We used to have good times together.
All right, there's books here.
Those are music, books, and sheet music underneath.
Sheet music, yeah.
But now I feel them slip away.
Oh, and that's the... Yes, I've got the album of that, as well. But,
it makes me cry.
Oh, with lovely pictures of Françoise on the front as well. That lovely long hair.
So sad to watch good love go back.
This is perhaps one treasured item. I managed to get that signed when I went to a record signing in Paris once. But I'd heard about that book.
Françoise Hardy, Superstar, a Ermite, as in hermit.
Yes, correct. Yeah.
It breaks my heart.
When I got the guitar, I had a small method to learn some chords so that I knew three or four chords. And I found out very quickly that I could find a tune which was more than less like all the tunes I was listening to on Radio Luxembourg.
And that encouraged you?
Yes, so at that time I was composing maybe one song a day. They were all very bad. They were all terrible, really.
I want to talk about Tous les garçons et les filles, which was a song I know you perhaps don't think very much of now, but at the time was a huge...
No, because I will tell you why. Because it's my most famous song, even today. And I never had, since this first song, such a success. And it's not my best song. Far from it. That's why.
So many friends that I happen to see have been steadily falling in love.
When Françoise left these boulevards for swinging London, she was embraced by the aristocrats of 60s pop. They loved her, and she had a particular fondness for Mick Jagger. In her autobiography I'm reading from here, she writes of being fascinated by his charismatic beauty.
I love you, yes I do.
But she asked herself, was he as shy as me?
That it'll always be true, so that I'll never be blue.
You met the Beatles, you met the Stones, Rolling Stones.
Yeah, very superficially.
Superficially.
Really. And yes, I went often to London, first of all to make my records, because I was very unhappy with French musicians, and also with the success of all over the world. I had been engaged by the Savoy, and after the show, I went to discotheques to have something to eat, and sometimes I met the famous singers of this time, especially Brian Jones, Mick Jagger. But they were very strange, and I was very shy in my corner, saying nothing, and I saw them passing by. And, I was like a very shy fan, you know.
But you write very colourfully in your autobiography about Mick Jagger.
I met him, I don't know, it's very strange. I met him on the street, and he smiled to me, and I smiled to him, and et j'ai pensé que je ne m'en remettrais jamais.
And I thought I would never recover.
Yes, really. He was like an angel, really. A dark angel. And he's the first one, he doesn't know that, but who gave me a little more confidence in myself, because in an interview for a French magazine for young girls, he said that I was son idéal féminin.
Oh, his ideal woman.
Yes. In fact, from the moment I went to England, I had a little more confidence, because in France, the image I had was the image of a shy girl, the image of my first song, you know, I had this. And when I went to England, I had another image. I felt, for instance, that the journalists were much more interested in my look than in my songs.
When we were at school, we used to have parties, as people do, and one Easter, one of the girls from a neighbouring school brought along this pen friend, and this pen friend was French, from Deauville, and she was a complete lookalike for Françoise Hardy.
Que je m'ennuyais de trop penser à toi.
Well, the effect on the lads was instantaneous. Everyone kind of fell about, swooned. And I was the only one that had the courage to ask her out. Being 17, asking her out where to, God knows, but I think we went to Droitwich Lido on a freezing cold day.
Did it last?
It lasted 10 days, then she went back and that was it.
J'aurais bien dû m'en aller, mais tu...
I was for a very long time passionately in love with her. Every male in the world and a number of females also were, and we all still are. Not my words, but those of David Bowie, one of a string of British musicians who fell for Françoise.
It's impossible for me to believe it. I think he has said that because it was for French TV, that's all. And I think it's certainly very exaggerated.
Bob Dylan was also a big Françoise fan. Indeed, he dedicated a poem to her on one of his early albums. But in 1966, when Françoise came to see Dylan perform in his first concert at the Paris Olympia, she was in for a really big surprise.
Unfortunately, he was in a very bad shape. He was not very well singing. He was not very well playing the guitar. He was often out of tune, things like that. And the interval lasted a very long time, so that the audience became impatient, not angry, but...
impatient.
Ils sifflaient, enfin les gens sifflaient, etc.
They were whistling.
And suddenly, somebody came to me and said, Bob Dylan will not go back to stage if you don't go to his dressing room to meet him. Yes.
And so you did?
So I did. I didn't speak very well English, and he wasn't speaking French, so it was really terrible. And he played to me two songs, which were not released at that time, Just Like a Woman and I Want You.
Nobody has to guess that baby can't be blessed till she...
A few years ago, I read in the press that he had asked about me.
All right.
So I was very flattered, really, very flattered.
She takes just like a woman. Yes.
How did you, as a self-confessed shy girl, how did you cope with this fame that you achieved?
In the same time, I met my first boyfriend, Jean-Marie Perrier, and I was only preoccupied by my personal life and by him and by the songs he inspired me. And the rest, I didn't see it. I didn't care. I didn't enjoy at all everything which happens when all of a sudden you become very famous.
You know, you were taken up by the fashion houses, weren't you, as well? I mean, this must have been a fantastic thing for you.
C'était une corvée pour moi.
It was a trauma for me.
It was a trauma for you.
Yes, really.
Really.
Des choses que je devais faire. C'était du travail, une corvée vraiment.
At the time, it was work, things I had to do, a chore.
I didn't enjoy it at all.
Are you thinking of me now? Missing having me around. If you have forgotten me.
So far so good. You think, oh, then it's going to resolve back to the beginning again. But it doesn't. It goes,
my world will come
tumbling down. And then back to the beginning again, which is a very strange thing tacked onto the end musically, but it works because the way the lyrics take the song.
I think the first fans you have are people who think you are like them or they are like you.
I'm not sure how true it was, but I remember reading somewhere that she wanted to have a baby but didn't want to get married. So it would be rude not to offer my services, but it cost me an absolute fortune in stamps.
You're joking. You actually wrote to her, didn't you?
Absolutely, yes. So, several letters. Yes, I cringe now when I think of it. Still, I was only 14 at the time. Watching the sun's
fading light. It's very difficult for me. It's quite impossible to stand to be admired too much. You know, it's not a normal situation.
You don't like that?
No, I don't like that at all.
Would you say you were a fanatic?
It's all relative, isn't it? I suppose I am a fanatic, yes. Maybe less so now than I was in the past.
Fans Tony Bray, Warren Gilbert and Roy Hawksford. That I still love you so. In recent years, the albums have kept coming, as have a number of collaborations with British musicians. They include Blur's Damon Albarn and, more recently, singer-songwriter Ben Christophers. Françoise caught one of his songs on the radio, and it developed from there.
And I couldn't really believe it, because I've known her all my life. And so it took me about 3 months to write her a letter, because I really, really wanted to somehow... My dream was to write with her. But you know what? How do you write a letter to someone like this that is kind of... I don't know, a real icon. Do you say dear, Françoise? But anyway, eventually I managed to do it. And she was really graceful. She wrote back to me and said how much she loved some of my songs and that she, you know, she'd love to write with me. And I couldn't believe it. I remember you in Sinfin. We didn't meet for years. We just wrote letters, sent CDs to each other. And it was like a real romance. It was really nice. We talked about the music, we learned that song, and it went on from there.
You said that you've known her all your life. I mean, you're not that old, so how did you know of her and her work?
Well, just through my parents playing her music, you know. And my uncle was a massive fan of hers as well, so I was always seeing album covers with this, you know, woman that my uncle was always saying, this is real beauty. She's always been a very, very beautiful woman, but also she's got such grace and carries it with, I don't know, some kind of humble silence. My beautiful demon.
There have been some unlikely musical relationships too, including one with Malcolm McLaren and with rock's perennial bad boy, Iggy Pop.
He's the nicest bad boy I've ever met. And it was a great moment, really. I was very nervous because Iggy Pop is a very good singer, very, very good singer. He let me the choice of the song. He said to me, don't choose a too jazzy song because I'm not too good at it, he said to me on the phone. And it's always very difficult to be happy with everything. My Beautiful Demon with Ben Christophers and I'll Be Seeing You with Iggy Pop, two of my favorite recordings, really. It's almost perfect.
Your shyness has not really been a handicap to you, has it? Or has it?
What is difficult with this activity is that it ça vous enferme.
It closes your eyes.
Dans une bulle.
In a bubble.
Yes. And c'est mon tempérament aussi de m'enfermer.
And it's also in my temperament to remain closed in.
So... It's not a very healthy thing.
I'll find you in the morning sun, and when the night is new, I'll be looking at the moon, but I'll be seeing you.
Though now grey-haired and heading towards her 70s, this reluctant French icon is as striking as ever. And for me, her voice is as captivating now as it was all those years ago when I first fell for Françoise.
There is a real style to her. She's managed to stay in fashion throughout her career.
She wrote her own songs. She was beautiful. She was intelligent. Songs were melancholic and really resonated with a chap in his young teens.
She's sort of everything you would probably want in a girlfriend, especially at that age. You know, she looks sort of level-headed and like she could probably play football with you, but also sing to you in French, which is pleasing for anybody.
Maybe it's difficult for people to understand that, but I've always lived for my personal life. I'm not comfortable with my professional life, really. So the word icon, it's as though you were talking about somebody else, you know. It's not me, really. This success never made me confident with myself and with my work. I feel happy and secure when I'm on my bed in my room with a good book. You know, my favorite writer, and I read him again and again and again, is Henry James. When I read a good novel by Henry James, I feel as happy as I can be. I forget everything which is terrible in our world.
Falling for Françoise was presented by John Andrew. The producer was Alan Hall, and it was a Falling Tree production for BBC Radio, first broadcast in 2011.